Block Radio Show. This is JP Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Car Block at King Car Block and CarBlock.org, and we else have.
Yeah, this is Matt from Carbon County Car Block out of Pennsylvania. You know, Carbon County Car Block or Facebook.com, and also on YouTube. And then there's also.
I'm Scott Marshall from the Oath Accountability Project, co-founder along with Matthew Taylor. And that's Oath Accountability Project on YouTube and Facebook.
And Matt, you said you have some information on the app, TuneIn app?
The TuneIn app, over at lrn.fm, over on the Play Store and App Store. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, all you guys got to do is just go over there and you can just download it for free. It'll just play what is currently playing on LRN at the time. It's a great app to have, you know, whether in your car, or, you know, just working out, you want to listen to some good radio. Just go ahead and download that and you can tune right on in.
Sounds good.
All right, I guess we'll go right into, man, I saw this video just a few hours ago. I had some bad news this week about my family case. I'm actually losing 6 hours. So I've been working on a 10-page appeal because I'm prevented from having video recording at my child exchanges, which is in an open form right out in the parking lot of the police station. So I'm highly going up against that. But that's why I had the chance to see this video a little later. But I guess a cop pepper sprayed some bikers in Texas. You guys see the video?
Oh yeah.
My God.
Yeah, like, so these guys are just out on a joyride. It's a nice day. They're just minding their own business and riding around the state. And what does he do? He gets out of his car and just decides to mace him for no reason.
Hey, that's psychotic behavior. I mean, that should be like attempted murder. I mean, because he's trying to get motorcyclists to wreck. I mean, on a motorcycle, if you wreck into something solid even 30 miles an hour, you're almost dead.
Now, do you guys know if Texas has the move over law?
I am not aware currently. I can take a look at that while you guys discuss this for a few more seconds.
Yeah, because I'm thinking maybe he got pissed that they didn't move over and he felt like he had the authority to actually spray somebody while they're driving. Man, I know if that was me, man, we'll be having this conversation in front of a Superior Court judge with a check that comes behind it.
Well, I believe the law would be that you either have to slow down or move over. And
if it's safe.
You can only move over if it's safe. And I think that the traffic was actually pretty backed up there at that moment.
I think there was over 100 bikers.
Right now, it's Texas Transportation Code 545-157 requires drivers nearing stopped emergency vehicle with lights activated to either slow down or change lanes. So they weren't doing anything wrong.
Yeah, it looked like they were going pretty slow to me.
Yeah, they were slowing down.
So what the hell? Does anybody know what if there was a statement from the police department? It was Fort Worth, right?
I believe so, yeah. I'm looking at it right now. Let me see. It looks like it is Fort Worth.
And the police department's refusing to release the cop's name.
Oh, yeah, they don't want this out there. Think about that. You know, that is not only the douchebag of the week for us, but that is absolutely the douchebag of the week for the world. That's going to get out there. Like, cop just steps out. It's like, oh, let me just pull out my mace and spray it all over.
Yeah, I don't see any reason whatsoever to get out of your car during a traffic stop, which he's probably not even supposed to be doing anyway, and then macing a passerby. And I believe the one he hit had a passenger too. So that's putting two people in danger.
Yeah. And not only there's a cloud, but I'm looking at the picture right now, and it looks like these bikers are pretty much all the way out. Like, in the farthest, you know, quarter of the lane, it looks like they're in. So they're not even posing a threat to this officer at all.
Now, let's just think if these cops weren't on video, the stuff that they think they can actually get away with, if he thought he could get away with something like that is assault at its best. I mean, it's assault.
Absolutely. You know what, though? Props to the guy for wearing a GoPro on the top of his helmet, so he got that on camera, because otherwise it's just their words against his.
Man, it's so video is so great in that aspect where cops are being held accountable just from a joyride.
Yeah, just from somebody passing by, like
not even cop logging.
Not even that meant to go out and videotape police. Like, he was videotaping and just happened to see this happen. Like, good thing he turned around to look, because, I mean,
he wouldn't have caught it if he didn't turn around.
Yep.
But he kept his eyes on the police officer. I wonder why. Because people are very nervous.
Yep.
And of course, that's the one of the reasons why people are very nervous, because they pull shit like that.
Yeah, I mean, in Texas being a big authoritarian state, I wouldn't set foot in that state without a camera rolling.
Oh, yeah.
I know my wife lived there for almost 5 years, 5-6 years.
Yeah, is it as bad as, you know, one would think with, you know, the authoritarianism?
I don't know. I think the whole border, too, the border patrol and the Minutemen and all that, I think those people are a little bit gung ho and a little too vigilant. I'll keep my political side of it close, because you know I'm of native blood, so you know I have a whole different type of view when it comes to immigrants and closing the borders and all that shit. And doing it by force is, I don't think doing it by force is the best way. I am just not a very big fan of guns.
I mean,
no, I agree with
without delving into it, I mean, me myself, I'm not a fan of borders to begin with. I think it's counterproductive to a peaceful society, but you know, without delving into it really.
Yeah. It's like a no-win situation for anyone with a country that was formatted and begun by immigrants. I mean, if any of these people on that border, especially Minutemen, looked at their lineage, I bet you they can trace back three, four generations. They're not going to be here. They're going to be Germany or Scotland or Ireland or England. You know, the only ones that were here were Native American, you know, some of the tribes. Yeah, Japanese too. But to have that type of vigilance where you think you can just get out of your cruiser and spray somebody in the face while they're on a motorcycle is just absurd to me. It actually aggravates me. I want to be out till 3 a.m.
I thought it was pretty bold, you know, what was it, last year when that cop gets out and it was at that protest. All those kids were just sitting down after they'd been caught, and he's just walking up and down the line spraying them.
Oh, that was a sit-in at a college.
Yeah, I thought that was bold, but this, I think, is even worse, because there's, as much as there was no reason for that one, there was, I can't even put connection, like, to how that could even possibly cross his mind. But,
well,
hey,
check
you know, let's get out and mace him.
Well, check
without something malicious.
Check this out. I was in Portsmouth during kind of like the middle stages of the Uber protests going on down there with Christopher David. And during Keenevention, he said, we want some cop lockers down there with some cameras in some of the bar, in some of these bar bouncers' faces and the cops' faces, because they're pressing the Uber drive is really, really hard down there. And I was talking to another activist from the Manchester area. And I said, watch this. This is how cops are going to react. And he goes, what are you going to do? I'm like, I'm going to walk up to that cop at a safe distance and just stare at him for a minute. I will guarantee he's going to approach me and start asking me a bunch of questions, because this is how they're trained. He goes, no way, no way. I actually paid him, I bet him $5. I'm like, watch. So I sat in there near the telephone pole, and I just sat there and stared at him. And sure enough, he came over. He goes, are you safe right now? Have you been drinking? What is your name? Where are you coming from? I had all my cop lock gear on. I had the camera out. It's like, none of that even mattered at that point. He was on war mode to just try to interrogate me and have that preconception.
Wow.
And that just shows you, you know, the attitude in which they portray themselves and how they're trained.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Sounds like we're going into a break.
Yeah, and this is the Cop Block Radio Show. We'll be back with some more topics and get into it in a little bit. And we are back on the Cop Block Radio Show. This is JP Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block and King Cop Block and CopBlock.org. And
this is Matt from Carbon County Cop Block on Facebook and YouTube. And
this is Scott Marshall from the Oath Accountability Project, also on Facebook and YouTube.
So this story and this Portsmouth protest that I went to, which was very enlightening because I'd never met any of the Free Coasters before, because I'm not FSP, so I'm not usually in their circles. I'm only been involved in the activism that's been going on in the Keene area and just Cop Block meetups elsewhere and out of state. So it was actually really cool to go to an actual protest. I'm not a very big fan of sine waves. I don't see the productivity in it, but I see where, you know, how other people can have a voice. And I was trying to prove a point to one of the protesters on how cops react, and his reaction is exactly how I anticipated it to be. And then this is how they're trained. This is how they act, and they are programmed, to do things like this mace thing. I bet you, I would say maybe 6 out of 10 cops would have done what he did. you know, that's all in a ball of wax. You really only have that wax. You really have no different types of cops. There's only one type of cop, and it's the one that's out there preconceiving everything that they can to think you're a criminal. And that's, I mean, spraying somebody that he doesn't even know, never even met, never even talked to, he basically has that much respect for people, obviously.
Right.
Yeah, and if we caught that on camera, what's the stuff that he's done that's, you know, really bad? If he's willing to do that, you know, endanger strangers' lives. And, you know, to me, it didn't even seem like there was any real purpose to it except for, I don't like motorcyclers.
Right.
Yeah. Yep.
I think he was just pissed that they were too close to the car, and he had a butt hurt up his butt, and he wanted to see if he could do something about it like a jerk.
That, or it was a longer train, and the beginning of it scared him when he was sitting in the car, so he got out and sprayed him.
Jeez.
Well, I mean, maybe he's just disgruntled. I mean, I read something recently that said that, you know, a lot, most cops don't like their jobs. So, I mean, you know, friends don't let friends become cops. And, you know, if you're disgruntled and you're a police officer, try a different profession.
Yeah, right.
Jeez. So we have this story, right? And I've been trying to catch up on the facts because there's new facts popping in. This Gates, New York police officer accused of choking a 15-year-old while in handcuffs. Wow, we heard that one before.
Wow.
Yeah, this is a story, like you said, it originates up in New York, and basically what it says went on is that Officer Sean O'Mara first punched a 15-year-old student, his name is Joe, they don't have a last name, but only after the 15-year-old threatened to punch the officer. And that is coming from Police Chief James Van Broedrode. I think it's Van Broedrode. I don't know, that's a hell of a last name.
So I'll take that with a grain of salt.
Well, it says that his camera, his lapel camera, proves that he was justified in punching the student. I don't see how violence is justified on a threat of violence.
Okay,
I know if a soldier reacted like that, there'd be in Leavenworth. In Fallujah, if he just shoots somebody that said he's going to shoot him, he'll be in Leavenworth. But a cop most definitely will get away with it.
So it says that Officer O'Mara grabbed Joe Quinones and threw him on the ground, handcuffed him, and then proceeded to turn him over and beat him with his fists in the face. Below, you'd find pictures of his face, his wrist, and where he was handcuffed and where he was choked. And then further down in the article, you can see where he's got big old welts over his head and behind his, neck.
Those are contusions.
It also says that the argument started because of a cell phone being confiscated. So basically his rights were being violated to begin with, and he's probably sticking up for his rights and say, listen, you can't grab my cell phone. And here we are, getting a minor, a child, basically getting beat, his head beat in by the cop.
Over a cell phone.
I could say this is the second time that in a little while that we've reported on this. I mean, there was down in Baltimore a couple weeks back where we had that kid who got jacked up, and luckily that one was on camera. But they have this one on the body camera, and if it proves that he's innocent, can we see it?
Yeah, can you release the video? I mean, what's the point in the body camera if you're not going to release it?
Right.
Well, I just it doesn't make sense to me. If this exonerates your officer and it shows that he was in mortal danger to where he has the ability and rights to do this to a 15-year-old child, then please, by all means, show your video, because then you will win the court of public appeal and it'll back off. But if you can't do that, don't lie about it and still release the video so the public can see what your officer is made of.
Yeah, I mean, either way, every aspect of that is supplied by public funds. I mean, every, except for the victim, but everything else is public funds, so it should be made available to the public.
The thing that bothers me is the civil courts and the high courts have been sticking up for the people for the most part. You have to sue them, they win, they get a settlement, you know, it goes to jury. The jury, I would say 9 out of 10 times, is for the person that got damaged and hurt and has a ton of hospital bills because of a police brutality thing. I was involved in one. That's how I got involved in cop block to begin with. But why isn't there firm prosecution? And why are police officers sticking up for their own people? Now, I would really love to see a cop on the side of the street and yell at another cop, be like, you can't do that. You don't act like this. These are people we're supposed to have commerce with. Why are you beating them up?
The closest thing that I ever came to that was we're out there for the November 5th protest, and I had a bunch of cops around, you know, hassling me, and I'm, you know, showing them the law where I can do what I'm doing. And the lieutenant, the white shirt, walks up and starts talking to me, and then the other guy tries to butt in, and the white shirt takes his hand and, like, puts it on his shoulder, like, hey, man, be quiet.
I caught that on video.
I mean, it was such a small gesture, but so glorious.
It's nice to catch somebody that's probably been doing it for years, nabbing them just once. And you think, when you get something like that on videotape, and you touched on it on the story before, how many more times has he done it? Like, what other assault of behavior does this guy ever had in his career? I'm not sure if I remember the story, but it was this cop stealing chips from this store, and apparently it was happening for like over like a 5-year period. But you know, once a criminal, they're a criminal, and they use the badge to get away with it. Yeah. Badges don't grant extra rights, and now
no,
it's.
No, they don't.
All right, we're going to another break, and we'll be back on the Cop Block Radio Show with some more topics and more discussion in a little bit.
Stay safe out there.
And here we are at the Cop Block Radio Show, and this is JP Freeman from King Cop Block, CopBlock.org, and New Hampshire Regional Cop Block, and New Hampshire Regional Cop Block YouTube. And we have Scott and Matt from Penn and up in the house, OG Cop Blockers, and we're talking about some discussions here. And you guys can introduce yourself again.
This is Matt from Carbon County Cop Block. You can find me on Facebook at Carbon County. Go ahead and give it a search. I'm on Facebook and YouTube. And you got Scott?
I'm Scott Marshall from the Oath Accountability Project. That's Oath Accountability Project at YouTube and the Facebook.
Now, before we get to the next story, I want to ask you, Scott, what made you start doing cop locking or the Oath Accountability Project? Because I really don't know the backstory to that at all.
Well, it just comes from... back being a youngster running around. I'm from Richmond, Virginia, and down there we got a lot of a whole lot of police. It's too many. I mean, one police is too many, but we just have way, it's overkill. And, you know, I just found myself getting hassled more and more. And then, you know, I one day heard in passing somebody mentioned something about cop block. So, you know, I went and checked it out and, you know, they had all this information on, you know, what you can do to help out and how you can, you know, exercise your rights. And I was instantly hooked and, you know, I've been doing it ever since. Getting better every day and learning every day.
How did you guys meet up? How did both of you get together? Were you friends beforehand?
I'll let you tell it, Matt.
Well, basically, you know, I stopped working for a grocery store that Scott started working in right afterwards. We had started hanging out just through mutual friends, and then out of nowhere, we were just, you know, basically started having conversations about, you know, stuff that were happening with police and whatnot. Scott found this newspaper one day that just happened to really speak to us because they were reporting on some of the things that we were having issues on. We joined up with them, and honestly, we've been doing cop blocking and stuff like that ever since. That started with a school board, which was more government stuff, but then it turns around and, you know, like November 5th and the we, you know, started getting interested in that and paying attention to a lot of the videos that were coming through. Scott introduced me to cop block just by showing me the site with a bunch of other ones. We really, you know, we've been friends for beforehand, but once we found that, it was really just off to the races. We really, you know,
it was cop block and 9/11 videos all day.
Yeah.
Well, they actually have activists here. Few of the, you know, similar names doing the same stuff a lot with the schools. We have a guy named Conan that presses the school board here a lot, and a couple others, and I've been learning a little bit more of that aspect because I'm in the courts. Like on Thursday morning, I'm in the court all morning long till like noon. I'm there from 8 to noon. I don't take a plea at the door for about maybe 35 minutes or so. And I actually go in and I hear all the cases. And then I kind of ambush people at the end and kind of give them input. And then we exchange numbers and I start building a network of people. Especially if I hear they got stopped in a very, very suspicious manner, like, oh, you didn't come to a complete stop, or which I know all of these are bullshit. This is how they gain revenue, and they can say whatever they want in order to detain you.
Your windshield has a chip in it. Now you owe me money.
Yeah, exactly.
It's exactly. Like, oh, you can't afford to fix your windshield. Now you really can't afford to fix your windshield.
Now, yep. I should be involved in the schools a little bit more because I have kids in the schools here.
You gotta pick your battles, man. You can't take on the world.
You can.
We didn't initially start really, you know, with this paper to do stuff to that with that school board, but he kind of asked us to help him with video recording, and some of the stuff that we started hearing really kind of ticked us off as we were, you know, recording, and you know, it made you want to go up and speak because this was our community, and they were trying to take these schools that could easily be fixed up for pretty cheap, and they wanted to tear five different schools down to build one mega school.
Jeez,
that would have put the community 105.6 million in debt.
Some
for
crazy
30 years.
So some crazy number.
That's a lot of traffic stops.
Yeah, that was going to raise our taxes horribly, which was going to raise, you know, the illegal revenues and stuff like that. So we were really against it. We ended up really putting such a thorn in their side and overturning one of their motions because of actions that happened at the meetings that we were at. So long story short, you know, we won that. And ever since then, you know, kind of been working with the paper until it was sold off.
When I was invited to the state house and we spoke for the re-amendment of the wiretapping bill to make it a, you know, a one consent state, and there was other stuff in the bill too that I agreed with. It was the first time I ever did that, and I'm glad I did to see the process and to meet the people. And I know some bureaucrats by name, you know, if I see them in passing. I do want to get into a little bit more of that on the cop block side and the investigative reporting side. I think it's very, very important for people to know that the mind frame of the police goes beyond the badge and the cruiser. And even their higher ups think exactly the same way they do. You know, even the New Hampshire Attorney General's office, you know, one of their biggest prosecutors, he went up there and he sounded just like a cop. I mean, identical. In his mindset and mind frame. Oh, these tools are very important to have because, you know, we could get attacked by terrorists and blah, 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 blah. Okay, we're all terrorists, obviously. And this is their mindset.
Under their eyes. Oh, yeah, everything we do is terrorism to them, considering.
Oh, they're freaking out. They get 3/4-inch steel tanks, you know, combat delivery vehicles in the middle of Bow, New Hampshire, that has like a population of 200 and probably a population of 500 moose. So they must be worried about the moose.
Didn't I see that Keene recently got an MRAP?
No, Keene got a beer cat. I believe that was 3.5 years ago when I first started doing cop lock. That was like one of the first protests I went to. Was the beer cat. They got it 3 years ago, I believe, yeah, 2013, 2014.
Yeah, I saw that mentioned on John Oliver, and I just thought that was, you know, interesting because, you know, you guys are right out of there.
Now, Vermont, even Burlington, Vermont, they actually, most cities and towns actually denied the Department of Homeland Security grant to receive a beer cat, which I kind of commended to Burlington. They basically gave a big middle finger and said, nope, we'll take care of our own self. And they really don't want the government to play any part in their state at all. Even when they had those floods a year and a half ago in Chester, Vermont, the federal government offered them millions to repair the damage. And then, like, no, we'll pay for it. So I kind of got to commend Vermont for kind of giving the big middle finger to the Fed. I think the people in their infrastructure there knows if they take something from the Fed, they're gonna have to give some back, give something back, yeah, right. And they don't want no. I mean, they don't even like DEA and ATF in that state. It's not a very big law enforcement state. They have more cops in Concord, New Hampshire. Just Concord, New Hampshire. This is just state police, and Concord than they do in the state police all in Vermont. Altogether, they have maybe a little under 100 state police officers in Vermont. That's true.
Wow.
You can travel 93. No, wait a minute. It's not 93. It's 89, I think. And not see one for like 3.5 hours and not see one.
Oh, wow.
But yeah, we're going to another break. And this is Cop Block Radio Show. And we got some good stories coming up. In a little bit, we'll see you in a bit. And we are back to the Cop Block Radio Show. This is JP Fien from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block, Keene Cop Block, and CopBlock.org. And we have
Matt from Carbon County Cop Block at Facebook. You can find me at Carbon County Cop Block and on YouTube at Carbon County Cop Block. And Scott?
This is Scott Marshall from the Oath Accountability Project. You can find that on Facebook or YouTube. That's Oath Accountability Project. And then we have Rick.
Sorry, hey, Rick from Allentown Cop Block YouTube and Facebook. How's it going, guys?
What's going on? I remember Allentown and doing a Cop Block meetup with you guys there, and I've been catching a lot of flack on that video because I specifically targeted Officer Peacock.
Yeah, I remember that one.
And the reason why I did this, and I just give me a second to explain, there was this cop sitting there, and it looks like he's the biggest bully in the planet. And sure enough, Severin goes and tells JP Freeman, that cop likes picking on people. So what do I do? I went in there and I tore them apart for a good 15 minutes straight. It's on video. You can find the video on Lehigh Valley Cop Lock. But yeah, I had a ball with you guys there. You guys are a hood.
Yeah, definitely. We always out there, you know, keeping them on a straight line.
Yeah, I just posted a recent video from being up there. I forgot what town it was. It was that unmarked car that had like the
Freemansburg.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I used to live right down the street from where that was when I was in high school.
But the weirdest, Rick, why don't you explain what happened to your camera with that car?
Well, I'll tell you one thing. When you uploaded that video, I was surprised. I forgot all about that. I had that video in my archive. So I went looking for it. And yeah, from my camera angle, it's like, I don't know if it's the phone or the cameras that are different, built differently. But from my camera angle, it's kind of like, I hear you guys talking about, you know, this car is not a marked car. And from my camera angle, this police sign is like lit up on my screen.
Yellow, right? It was like bright yellow.
Yellow, bright.
But on our camera, it looked black as day, and it looked like it was a subdued police underneath the paint.
Exactly.
It was like a ghost car.
Yeah, it was.
Weird.
It was freaky, man. Yeah, that guy didn't like me very much.
Yeah, he didn't. I think anybody that all the ones that came across to you did not like you.
Well, there's a tactic to that approach. It's not that I'm trying to be an antagonistic. I can pick up their mannerisms extremely well. Right. I can read a cop within the first 3 seconds he's speaking, whether he's going to be nice, his demeanor is going to be calm, or he's going to be a major brute. If he's going to do that authoritarian bullshit, I'm going to give it back first. I don't let him give the chance to get authoritative at all. And I overcome it. And in Allentown, especially that Officer Peacock didn't know what the fuck to do. I mean, I threw him off guard like he was a deer in headlights. Like, he's seriously, Severin told me that it was the first time he's ever not heard that guy run his mouth. So my job worked. What I did worked. I put him in his place, and now he feels like a peanut like the rest of them.
Yeah, they pretty I think they got the message, because when they see me, they go the opposite direction.
That's usually what we get. Hey, come here, I want to talk to you. What's your name? They just drive off, roll up the windows like a bunch of cowards. But hey, they'll pick on a 17-year-old girl.
Though. I don't know if you ever saw this ever happen. Have you ever seen a traffic minute under 4 minutes?
A traffic stop under 4 minutes?
Have you ever seen a cop conduct a traffic stop under 4 minutes?
No.
Like, here's the ticket, go.
No.
No. Well, yesterday was the first time.
And you got that on video, right?
Yes, I do. He tried to actually tell me either, I couldn't really hear him, but I could tell by the gesture of the way he was moving his hand, because I was standing there on the side of the cruiser. He's like, I think he wanted me to either stand in front of his cruiser or behind his cruiser. But I just basically just stood in that same spot and didn't respond to him.
Well, their CAD, their computer-aided dispatch probably got you flagged as a cop blocker, and they're warned. They're pre-warned about who to press the luck against and who not to press the luck against. And they're like, oh, this guy must know his rights, so let's get him the hell out of here as fast as we can, because I don't want to be splurged all over YouTube.
Yeah,
I think that's what's happened to me this past weekend. I got pulled over, and the cop was argumentative with me at first, and then he came back and he was immediately like, I'm gonna give you a break. And I was like, hey, but I'm not done talking to you yet. I didn't run that red light. And he tried to get out of there.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it could be the pending lawsuit, or it could be it could be that I'm flagged as a cop blocker, or maybe a combination. But he didn't want anything to do with me.
We've been pulled over before, and soon as they've walked up to the car, saw my wife or myself in there, they look, they're like, oh, geez. And they'll actually say that and be like, Jesus Christ. And then they'll walk right back to the cruiser, jump in, do a U-turn, and leave without even saying a word. That's happened to us on three different occasions here in Keene.
That's, I gotta take a trip up there. See how the how those boys are.
Yeah, well, they have a mindset, and they want revenue. They want to attack the revenue, get money from you, yell at you, but not with cobblockers. Nope. They know they can't get away with it, and they just leave you alone, and they move on to someone they can get away with it with.
Yeah, that's the same, like, similar to the same thing over here. It's like, when I'm around, they're on their best fucking behavior. Oh, excuse my language. They're on their best behavior. But when I'm not around, I start hearing things from the neighborhood, like, oh, they, you know, they did me dirty and stuff like that, you know, like other people talking about it. Like, you just hear people talking about things when you're walking around. And I'm like, really? Like, I don't go up to them and start asking them what really happened, you know, tell me more. But, you know, I'm like saying to myself, this only happens when I'm not around.
Right, right.
The police, they're kind of like the lions and the gazelles. Now, I'm not sure if I'm correct on having these two animals in the correct same place, but yeah, you got they go for the weak ones. You know, they're not going to go for the strong ones out in front. They don't bother with them. They bother with the weakest, most vulnerable ones.
They do. They absolutely do. Ricardo, what made you become a cop blocker? What's the beginning of your story?
I just started, the beginning of my story goes kind of like pretty farther back. This was maybe before people started recording cops. You know, I used to be involved with the, Law Enforcement Explorer as a kid in New York. And, as I got involved in that and I seen the corruption from being in, you know, showing up to classes and stuff and seeing what police officers were doing, like, it was just horrifying, and I was just like, you know what, this is not for me. And after 3 years of doing it, I kind of like, you know what, I'm out of here. And I just started going on and doing other things and stuff. And then I moved to PA about 5 years ago, and then I started watching YouTube and seeing all these traffic stops and people. I've seen the video with basically mostly everybody that's in cop block right now. I watched a lot of their old videos, and the straw that broke the camel's back is when I seen the old man get slammed for singing in my own town. And yeah. I was like, you know what?
I've seen that
enough
one.
Enough is enough. I say, you know what? I can't hang around and continue to watch this on YouTube.
How did you meet Severin? Bless his heart. He's really sick tonight, so I had to take over again. But
yes.
How did you meet Severin?
I tell you how I met him. I came across copblock.org page at one time. And then after I seen the old man get slapped, I called the police department. I asked to speak to the chief. None of them returned my call. I called the district attorney's office. Nobody returned my calls. So I went searching online for the site again. And I, you know, went on to groups. And I wanted to see if there was a group nearby where, you know, to try to get involved. And that's when I saw Lehigh Valley Cop Block under /groups on copblock.org.
Yeah, yeah.
And I gave Severin a call, and he started telling me, hey, did you hear about the FBI investigation, the raid of City Hall? I'm like, yes, I've been on top of that, you know? And next thing you know, he tells me, the next day he's like, oh, we're going to get together with two other guys and we're going to do a protest from the Hamilton Police Station. I was like, awesome, man.
Yeah.
I've been dying to go out, you know, hey, with a group of guys.
And we're heading right into a break. I want to hear the rest of that story. And we are here on the Cop Block Radio Show. We have Ricardo from Allentown Cop Block. And we'll be right back. And we are back to the awesome Cop Block Radio Show. And we got some people on. We got Ricardo, who just called in. And the other two OGs from Penny.
Yo, yo. It's Matt at Carbon County Cop Block and Scott.
Scott at Oath Accountability Project. That's Facebook and YouTube. Check it out.
And JP Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block. And Ricardo
from Allentown Cop Block, Facebook and YouTube.
So finish that story with how you met Severin Freeman.
So after, you know, doing making the calls and finding the local group, I found Severin and I spoke to him on the phone. And the next day, he picked me up to join a rally to protest against the old man getting slammed. So that's when I first met Scott and Matt from the Oath Accountability. And we met at the Hamilton Police Station in Allentown. And you could actually see that video on the Oath Accountability Project on their YouTube page.
Yep.
Yeah, that was a good time.
Yeah, man.
That was a fun day.
I definitely got to get up there. And meet all y'all for real.
Yeah, that'd be fun.
Look forward to it.
We were expecting you at the one rally, but
yeah, we got a late start. I think what happened was we got a late start and we weren't anticipating how long it was going to be for the drive itself, and we ended up taking a couple naps on the way because we were wiped out from that week anyway.
Yeah, like a 6.5 hour drive.
And what happened was we ended up going out later that night, and I missed that Friday altogether, I think.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
All right, man. Hey, Ricky, it was nice for you to be on.
Hey, it's good to hear from you again, man.
It was awesome hearing from you and talking into the show and sharing your experiences. And we have Scott, you got a story coming up.
Yeah, this is a story. It's out of Freehold, New Jersey. It's about a Neptune police officer. I'm getting a little bit of feedback here, but
you sound good to me.
Yeah, you sound good.
In Freehold, New Jersey, 9 children basically are without a mother because the father went on a crazy rampage and smashed up a car and then shot her 12 times and then, you know, threatened to kill himself with his 7-year-old in the car.
Jesus. And he's a cop?
Yep. Well, he was, but now he's in jail. But
at the time, he was a cop.
Yeah, he was. He used his sidearm, his police issue sidearm. And yeah, it was crazy. Like during the standoff, he texts all his kids and he was like, "Your mother's dead because of her actions." Apparently he was
kids.
Yeah, he was unable to cope with the fact that she came into the house with her kids and he lost it. He lost his cool.
Yeah, and I
this
bet.
This is ex-wife.
That's horrible.
Yeah, he ended up, and he texted a friend, and he was like, "Yeah, I got tired of her mess, so she's dead."
Jeez, with the U.S. I think it's like the United States something of crime statistics. They get put out by the United States Department of Transportation and all those 4-letter Fed groups. They say that police officers have the highest rate of domestic violence out of any other occupation in the U.S.
It's 4 times the average rate of any other occupation.
You know why? You know why?
Well, yeah,
it's the
because
authority.
They get pumped up, you know, bossing people around all day, and then they come home and they want to boss people around, and then, you know,
and their chicks
these
ain't
people
having
that
it.
Aren't intimidated by him, you know, get out of line, and then.
Oh yeah, their wives especially. Yeah. I know a cop here in town. I was actually at Walmart one day and she was ripping him apart, man. I was dying. I was like in the next aisle over and she was just tearing him up. "You don't treat me like that, blah 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 blah." I'm like, "Oh yeah, I guess they have wives like we do. And there's only 2 differences."
Yeah, well see, the thing about this cop, he went through a really nasty divorce, like, and he had many domestic violence things like against him already, and now his 9 kids are suing various police departments because they say that, you know, because of his record of domestic violence, he should have never had a badge and a gun to begin with.
The blue line covered his ass for years, I bet.
Yep.
what it sounds like.
There's actually a story. There's a story in Keene similar to that. There's a Sergeant Samarellis that got involved in a domestic, and they literally covered it, and no DVP was passed on him, because when you get a DVP, you have to lose your weapons, you have to turn in your ammo, your gun licenses, the whole bit. And yeah. They definitely stick up for their brother in blue.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, if these officers will do, you know, sadistic things and, you know, beat the people that they love, imagine what they're going to do to you, a stranger. Like, if you don't do exactly what they say, you know, I say don't let that make you afraid of them. Don't be afraid of the police. But, you know, that's just another example of, you know, what they'll do in uniform.
Look at it this way. Like, when you're walking down the street and, you know, you got somebody coming towards you and they're walking a dog, you don't know what kind of mentality that dog has. You're not just going to run up to it and, you know, just start petting it. If you do that, you run the chance of really, you know, getting bit. So the whole, you know, thing is, you know, step back, make sure, you know, you can handle the situation of which you're in. But at the same time, do not, you know, lay down and let them tell you what to do. Know your rights, and you should be able to get through it as best as possible.
Well, I want to show people, when I do cop lock, I want to show people how asinine they can be. Not only with their training, but the people that actually wear the badge, the person. And sometimes you have good interactions, and sometimes you have really, really, really idiotic ones, like this Swansea cop we keep bumping into. And I keep running into this guy, and I have, like, these short, really non-essential videos. That's why I haven't really posted much. Maybe I should start dropping those videos, because...
Just do a compilation.
This guy literally was at a motorcycle shop, a closed motorcycle shop, and I asked him, I'm like, so, what are you doing? Because I do the interrogating. If you haven't seen some of my videos in the listeners of Cop Lock Radio Show, I actually am the one that asks them questions first. I don't even let them get a word out. Oh, I'm getting gas. I'm like, you understand the nearest gas station is like 11 miles away, and you're at a motorcycle shop, right? And like, I catch these guys in lies because they believe in what they say. This is how dumb they can be. And the first time we bumped into him, he was at the fairgrounds, and he was pointing outward, and he's like, oh, I'm watching the building. I'm like, well, that's funny. Why are you facing the other direction? You're facing the street.
Just walk up to him and be like, are you okay? Your eyes look funny.
I've done that, too.
I think I smell some marijuana. Can you step out of the vehicle? I need to search this vehicle for drugs.
What are you doing here? Oh, I'm just making sure I'm safe. They like throwing that one out a lot, too. I'm just making sure I'm being safe with you standing here. I'm like, with me standing here, what the hell are you talking about? Do you just make shit up in your head? Or do you just come up with this shit while you're snorting coke and going to sleep every night with your donut, your cream-filled donut? Fucking douchebag. They aggravate me. They just aggravate me, man. The profession altogether just aggravates me.
Yeah, and it's most... Most of them just have a complete lack of respect for you. You know, they're trained not to trust you. So why should you trust them? I mean, it's a two-way street. And most people don't see it like that. They'd like to tout that you should respect an officer. And it's like, obedience is not the same thing as respect. Like, those are two different things.
And you know what?
You know that, right?
They are using that tactic in schools. My daughter was telling me the liaison officer had this big speech a few weeks ago trying to amp up their perception of police and how they're good people.
I mean, can I just interject? I'm going to digress for a second, but I think this idea that people send their children to strangers for, you know, six hours a day.
There's a break right here, and finish. I want to hear the rest of that, and we'll be back in a minute. Or a stitch. And we are back to the Cop Lock Radio Show. And this is JP Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Lock and CopLock.org.
This is Matt from Carbon County Cop Lock on Facebook and YouTube. And
this is Scott from the Oath Accountability Project on Facebook and the YouTube.
Now, this next story I was just reading a little bit about it. Is one
well,
of my
hold on. We were going into my digression. We were talking.
Oh,
about
the digression. That's right.
Yeah, digress, digress.
Digress.
Okay. Now when we left, we were talking about schools, and he said that, you know, in school, his daughter told him that the liaison officer gave a big speech about how you should listen to the police. And I was going to say, I think that it's insane that people send their children. Like, I understand it's a necessity for some people because you have to work and stuff. But as a society, we send our children to strangers for 6 hours a day, every day, for, you know, for your kids to absorb the ideals and stuff of another person. Like, I know most of it is, you know, there's that, you know, your children are gonna absorb, you know, certain things. And I think that is just, and then you have the school, which is, you know, basically it just teaches you to conform and that all knowledge comes from authority and yada yada.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just that whole thing is just insane to me, but digression over.
No, it makes I absolutely agree with what you said. I do. I think it's a bizarre practice that's worldwide, because you think about it, you know, they want to say, oh, well, these kids wouldn't have the opportunity to do these things if it wasn't there. But at the same time, if we taught our children from our, you know, our common knowledge, you know, these people would still be able to find a way. Not to mention, you have these kids in different countries who are building these incredible things, you know, and they don't have the same knowledge. What they did is they searched it, you know, they weren't forced into a different or a schooling like we have here, and they found what they wanted to know and they taught themselves how to do it, you know. So I'm not saying that it's a completely insane idea to have schooling, but at the same time, it should be really allowed to have, you know, a more of the family aspect to be able to figure out, you know, how to teach your own kids, so you don't have somebody growing up with ideas that I won't say aren't their own, but really are the ideas of an establishment as opposed to what you know, would want your child's beliefs to be.
Exactly. But to me, if you control a nation's children and you can teach them during their formidable years and you instill these kind of these ideals in them, like, you know, that if you don't conform, then you're going to be an outcast. And it's all strategic. You know, bullying happens for a reason. And it's all because we have this whole system that's designed to say that if you don't listen and if you don't, you know, if you don't repeat what you're told to repeat, then you're an idiot and you're a loser and you're going to be, you know, on the outside.
Well,
it's a scary concept.
Yeah, I think it's a tactic too. I think they purposely do that so they can preempt the future interactions with police. And I think they've done it at Keene State College, because I used to be like this huge celebrity, and now that officers have been trashing us and giving preconceptions and prenotions in all the kids' heads that all we do is criminals and harass police and ignore us when you see them. This is what they do at their orientations now, to try to combat the type of backup and feedback, the good feedback we get when we're on the street. I remember a year ago we passed out over 5,000. This is not a made-up number. Ian Freeman from Keene Coplock and FTL can and Free Talk Live can verify this number. 5,000 warning flyers were given out a year ago. This year we barely did 300.
Oh.
And it's all because the cops going in ahead of time during the orientations with the freshmen and going on this smearing campaign to go against Coplockers.
Wow, and like the public funds this. Because, you know, I thought there was supposed to be a thing where, you know, the police were supposed to be unbiased and they were supposed to, you know, look at everything objectively. And if there's evidence that, you know, that they're spreading, you know, bad things about you to other people and other police, then, you know, I thought that was something that wasn't supposed to happen.
I have a police officer here that's kind of my nemesis. It's one of the first cops I've ever targeted because of his bullshit. His name's Matthew Griffin. And I can't tell you.
God damn it.
I can't tell you. Well, that's my real name, too. That's my state name. He basically targets people in weaker vessels in order to gain revenue, either whether it be a traffic stop, open container, noise complaint. He doesn't go after the people that know their rights. He goes after the 16, 17-year-old girl that's like half-cocked and been drinking all night, and he can smooth things over and get a fine given. This is how much of a coward he is. I literally heard him in front of me on camera tell somebody, oh, he's not really from New York, or he's not from Boston. He's actually from New Hampshire. Are you out of your damn mind? Do I freaking sound like I'm from New Hampshire? I couldn't make this accent up if someone paid me. And to get the story straight, I lived in two places simultaneously because I had two different, separated parents. So I was with one parent during the school year and one parent during the summer. And in the school year, I was in Brooklyn, New York, and in the summer, I was in Brockton, Massachusetts, which is just outside of Boston. So I got the worst of both accents.
Is that what I'm hearing?
Baseball had to have been a horrible topic for everybody that you knew.
I'm not really. I wasn't really a baseball fan, but I like the Mets. But I am a Patriots fan, and my family in New York hated that.
Oh, man, I hate it too, but I understand.
Yeah, they didn't like
silly. It. People with your sports.
But you know, I like football, period. So I'm not really privy to one particular team. When I liked the Pats, they sucked. Now people just automatically assume you're jumping on the bandwagon because they've been winning a championship every 2 years.
No, I gotcha.
But I have that in mind. But this cop is like, no, he's not from who the hell do you think you are telling people where I'm from? Are you out of your mind?
That's insane.
I've been assaulted on two different occasions right after this guy's talked to some guys, too. So he tries to fill their head with all kinds of stuff. So it's not even a fine line. It's just downright illegal.
So it real sucks. Quick, let's get into this story.
Oh, yeah, the story.
Yeah, we had a story here. It's coming from a Countercurrent News, and says the DEA steals cash from innocent black man who they claim must be a drug dealer. They found no drugs on him whatsoever and never saw him selling drugs or committing a crime of any sort. But the DEA administration claims they are certain that 22-year-old Joseph Rivers is a drug dealer. What makes them so? When the young African-American man set out to make a music video in Hollywood, after scraping together the funds, the Michigan native had $16,000 for a shoot on him. So he had $16,000 on him, and they just automatically assumed this.
Jeez. Well, the break is coming up, and we'll be right back, and we'll finish that story up, and we got some more topics coming up on the Cop Block Radio Show.
Yeah, I didn't realize you were so close to that.
And here we are. We are back on the Cop Block Radio Show. And this is JP Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block at CopBlock.org. And we got Scott and Matthew. And we were just in the middle of the story about the DEA stealing some money.
Yeah, this is Matt from Carbon County Cop Block here. And where I was at was, Jose Rivera, or Joseph Rivera, my bad. He was traveling from Michigan to Hollywood. He had just scraped together everything he owned, $16,000, to go do a music video. And he was pulled over on the way and basically was found to have sufficient evidence to be labeled a drug dealer, even though no drugs were found on him. And even though there was absolutely no link between him and any criminal activity in the past. So his only crime was being black, and he had a lot of money on him.
You look like a drug dealer. He's going to a rap video shoot, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Well,
have you ever met a rapper that doesn't carry $5,000 in his pocket?
I'm sorry, he wasn't pulled over, but he was stopped. I read that wrong. But he was at the Amtrak station in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and it was on April 15th of last year. But the DEA agent wanted to search his bag because they were kind of wondering what his clothing, about him because of his clothing, and found an envelope of $16,000 in cash. So the DEA agents basically pull people aside at random, they say, and that he just fit the profile of a drug dealer. So apparently, when
We
you're young and
randomly picked this
African
drug
American,
dealer.
yeah, because you're young and African American, you're a drug dealer. But Rivers was the only African American in the vicinity when this happened.
Huh.
And
I don't understand how you can profile and be random at the same time.
right. It sounds like a highway robbery
It
right there.
is.
It really
It's
does.
the it's it they're just a three letter agency that are just born to be thieves. That's all the DEA
Yeah.
does is seize and steal. That's all they do. And they think they're a bunch of Navy SEALs dressed up like Ninja Turtles going into the jungles, and that's actually not what they do. They're a bunch of scumbags with three letters in yellow on the back of their jacket that basically gives them a right to take all your property, to steal you, detain you, preconceive you as whatever they want you to be, just so they can put 16 grand in their pocket to fund some illegal war down in Venezuela.
Yeah, and you know what? They still haven't released the money to him.
Oh yeah,
They
he's
did the
gonna
same
have to
thing with
go to
Fat
court
Stuff.
and prove that his money didn't commit a crime.
Yep.
There's a place called Fat Stuff here that sells glass products and other products, and they basically had all their stuff stolen, and you can find that video on freekeen.com. And most of the activists got all of that on video. And recently, the owners of that place ended up taking a plea deal, and they dropped all the felonies involved. But I'm not sure if they're going to get all their items back. It was something like $28,000 worth of merchandise they took, and this is their livelihood. And
Oh,
this is the
wow.
DEA we're talking about.
That's insane.
Yeah, they're a
Government, oh,
three-letter.
government.
If they wear a three-letter agency on their back, they're there to either kill you, steal from you, rob you, or murder your animals.
I can
Or
see
fund your
that.
illegal war.
I mean, I don't understand how these cop lovers everywhere can't take a nice hint and take a lesson from the dead. I mean, they've been doing this stuff since Waco.
Right.
Oh, he killed himself and all the people inside. Are you kidding me? You put a tank shell through their building and you're wondering
Yeah.
why it burned to the ground.
An incendiary tank at the a tank shell at that.
And don't get me started with all the other FBI debacles in the past, 25, 30 years. I mean, when they go
9/11 was a
in,
lie.
yeah, when they go in, 30 plus people die, plain and simple.
Yeah.
They're an
Yeah.
occupation force against the Posse Comitatus Act. The government cannot band together as a military force to enter property, buildings, places, or people's livelihoods or their houses. Plain and simple. It's
And don't you
against
know?
the law.
Don't you know that when you expose the FBI, you commit suicide?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Yeah,
Yeah,
we all know about Gary Webb. You know, he shot himself twice in the back of the head with a 12 gauge. I mean,
That's still.
tragic.
They've been
It's
lying.
tragic.
They've been lying since JFK, man.
Yep.
And of course, all the conspiracy theories that came out of that. I mean,
He was shot by
this
Secret
whole,
Service.
yeah,
How do you
Secret
lose a
Service.
brain? How do
Yep.
you lose a brain? It's a brain. It's not like you just like toss it in a pile of laundry and
Oh no,
like
that's
lost it in the
not to
corner.
mention the forceful things they did to the doctors
Oh yeah.
in
Oh yeah.
Texas, making them not do an autopsy by gunpoint,
Right.
no less. Oh,
Yep,
by the way,
it's the good
we're
old
taking
government
this body
hardover.
whether you like it or not. By force, they took that body.
The people that repaired the windshield with the bullet hole in it, you know, the bullet hole that didn't exist.
Yeah.
I mean, just there's so much with that. It's that's one of the more obvious. I think that is more obvious than the 9/11.
Well, plain and simple, the three-letter agencies think they have the power to lie, steal, and cheat, and murder. And
If you got a badge.
I think if you wear a gold badge that says U.S. on it, and I don't see the U.S. Marshals Service having a very, very bad reputation with years and years of bad reps. In fact, it's an agency that was made from outlaws to begin with. To go after really, really bad criminals that actually killed people. So, in fact, if you go into in the Manhattan office, one of the first things you see on the top, and it was Wyatt Earp that came up with this saying. He said, if there's no victim, there's no crime. So basically, the agency's built on the premise of only going after criminals that cause real victims. Right. Now, these other agencies, like the FBI, they were built on lies, espionage, and tricking people into getting what they want from the very beginning. And that doesn't, I mean, I don't want to be no conspiracy theorist, man, but if you look at their background and their history, do the freaking math. It does not take a 3-year-old toddler genius to figure out that that's all these people do is steal, murder, and lie.
Yep.
They are trained in Langley, Virginia, to lie to you. They're trained to lie. Their whole outlook is to fib, to keep things secret, and to just lie to you.
Yep. Status quo.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And they can, you know, personally, I think they could take their gold badges and shove it up their ass, but... But yeah. I'm not going to trust any of them as far as I can poop on them.
I'm inclined to agree with you.
No, I'm right there with you.
And I don't know, this preconception of I think we have a racist problem with law enforcement. I don't think I know. And if a cop tells you they don't specifically target a black dude and a black guy driving through Keene with a BMW with, you know, $1,200 rims, they're lying. They're lying through their teeth if they don't find a reason to pull him over.
Yep.
Versus a soccer mom and a minivan that has, you know, those little children on the back, the stickers on
and
the back.
Air bumper
and little do they know, yep, this chick could be some serial killer that put the stickers on because she's that smart.
Yeah. You know, if I was some nefarious, like, dude, I'd be driving around a minivan with license plate that says SCCR mom, and you know.
Oh, that's what drug dealers in New York, they're starting to do that in Brooklyn. They actually get those magnets with like businesses printed on them, and they stick them on their car, and they start driving around. They never get pulled over. It's perceptions. Cops are trained in perceptions.
Yeah.
Now, if me and you put like big, big gold rope chains on, and we carried $15,000 in our pocket, and we go rent a BMW, you know, low to the ground with light effects and stuff, and we drive through like 8 communities in New Hampshire, I will guarantee
you. Rap music.
Oh yeah, I guarantee you we'll get pulled over at least 6-7 times.
Yep. Yeah. But if we were to get in something like a Buick. Like, not a nice Buick.
You'll never get. But this is a break.
Wearing, like, a cardigan and stuff. It won't happen.
Yeah, this is a break, and we'll come back with some more discussion, some more topics in just a little bit on the Cop Block Radio Show.
Cop Block Radio Show.
Cop Block Radio.
And we are back to the Cop Block Radio Show, and this is J.P. Freeman from New Hampshire Regional Cop Block, Keene Cop Block, and CopBlock.org.
This is Matt from Carbon County Cop Block. You find me on the Facebook and YouTube.
This is Scott from the Oath Accountability Project. You can also find me on YouTube and the Facebook.
The Facebook.
So we have a couple stories.
The first one I want to talk about comes out of Dayton, Ohio, and it's just an intimidation tale. An Ohio cop out of Dayton, Ohio, decides that he's going to pull an African-American over. Now, the cop was Caucasian. Let's not get into race, but it's in the story.
Caucasian-American.
Yes, Caucasian-American. And basically... the man was pulled over for not breaking eye contact with the officer when he drove by. He was pulled over because he didn't have enough, or he wasn't intimidated enough to look away when the officer was staring down.
I would love for a cop to do that to me.
And there's a video of it. It's out there.
That's almost as bad as saying, yeah. Yeah. And then all of a sudden you're incriminated about everything because you said, Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to arrest you and pull you over because you were staring at me too long, young man. So now you're detained.
You should try that yeah with a question mark on the end. Yeah?
Huh? Oh, yeah?
See, I wouldn't say yeah. I'd be like, you're a goddamn liar and you're a piece of shit and you're coming up with... Get out of the car.
I will come in your shoe. Sorry.
And you get out of the car. Because now it's a state police safety issue. Because you said I'm a liar. My life is threatened because you called me a liar.
You didn't follow my order to a T.
And now I'm pulling you over because you just stare at people too long.
Yeah, that's just a ridiculous.
That is disturbing on like five different levels, man.
Yeah, it really is.
Let's pull you over, stop your right to free travel, and pretty much violate every fucking constitutional right you have because you were staring at me too long.
We made eye contact.
You must be ISIS.
We shared a moment, yeah.
You must be ISIS. What if the guy just happened to be homosexual and he actually thought the cop was cute? That'll be a lawsuit waiting to happen.
I'd be like, yo, what if the cop was homosexual instead?
Well, I pulled you over because, I'm interested in you. This is the new type of Tinder.
Like me?
This is the new type of Tinder. This is the cop lender. I don't know.
Hey, I just met you. This is crazy. Here's a citation. I'll call you, maybe.
Right? Okay. And he'll say it just like that too.
That was horrible.
Oh, man.
I'm sorry to everybody. We're just having a lot of fun here tonight.
We definitely have to get more cop blockers out there to get interactions like this. I'm stopping you over because you're making direct contact bullshit with me. Now, Matt, you said you had another story, the Jeff Gray story.
Yeah, this is, I think Scott knows a little bit about this as well. This is loading up on my screen here.
Not very much, unfortunately.
But a Florida deputy illegally arrests a photography is not a crime reporter at a high school. Jeff Gray has been released finally from St. John's County Jail, but here's a statement. He said, I am out of jail and safely home. I walked out of jail around 1 p.m. I was treated well by the SJOS jail staff. I want to thank everybody for their support and calls to the jail. Word got to me that the phone lines were melting. But basically what happened
That makes
was
it so
Jeff
much
Gray-
better. You treated me nice and gave me food, even though I'm locked the fuck up.
But it says Jeff Gray had been arraigned, and his wife has confirmed to PNAC News that she posted bail, which was $250. So they weren't like hitting him crazy hard. Let me find exactly why he was picked up.
For recording
trespassing.
You know, it's because of recording.
It's exactly what it is.
And this whole schools thing. If you don't have a Channel 9 on the side of your van. And you're a pretty lady in a miniskirt, you're not allowed to be on school property and video record any story whatsoever. You're just basically looked at as being some perpetrator videotaping 12 and 13-year-old kids because you're some psycho. You're not really there for a story.
Right.
Yeah, and the thing is, I know for a fact this is not his first arrest because I've seen a video before where this guy, he had not only did he have a his cell phone camera, he had a camera on his ear that looked like a Bluetooth, and he also had a sound recorder on him.
Nice.
And he got everything.
He's prepared.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know about you guys, but when I cop lock, I don't only have my HD handheld. I actually have my MoveEye going.
Yeah, I have a little MoveEye too.
Yeah, it's a little mini cam that clips on your belt. It kind of looks like a pager with a lens. And these things are super, super awesome, man. The clarity and the audio. I know Pete Air wears one. In fact, neither one of us knew we had one. And one day we're like, holy crap, you got one too? So I was pretty good. But the Move Eyes are great. They're fairly inexpensive, and they come with a mount for your car. They come with all kinds of accessories where you can use it as like a GoPro.
It comes with a nice little felt bag that you can stick it in.
Yeah, and it comes with really a little bag and a clip and a belt clip, and it comes in handy. And that it seems like this is sort of like what that Jeff had.
Yeah, I'm about to get some really awesome equipment coming up next month, of course, after my YouTube and my paycheck comes. But I don't want to give anything away yet, but it's going to be really really awesome.
So Matt, why don't you go ahead and tell the folks what they can get at the CopLock store?
So if you go ahead and you head over to coplock.org/store, you can pick up amazing things like hoodies, shirts, sweatpants, bandanas. You can even get your custom number on your cops or badges don't grant extra right badge from CopLock. Also, while you're doing that, you should also then pull out your phone and go to either the App Store or the Play Store, whichever one that you use, and you should get the app Cell411. Now, what this app is going to do for you is save you in the long run. Not only can you allow your friends and everybody in your cell circle to know if you're in danger, whether you got pulled over, whether your car broke down, or just generally alert them that you're going cop blocking, but when you actually get into a situation that you want everybody to see, you can live stream them directly to their phone what is going on. It is a lifesaver not only for the cop blocking community, but then also just for, you know, your family as well. So I would say definitely go ahead and head over there. Also, while you're in the App Store and Play Store, check out the app Absence Archives. It is a complete guide to show you every single officer, every single person that was killed by an officer up to this date of the year. It's a pretty powerful app. You should give it a whirl. But I would like to also thank Severin Freeman for, you know, being here for the show that where normally he's on, that we stepped in again for him. He was still feeling a bit under the weather. Just want to give a nice thank and shout out to him.
Get well, Severin.
Yeah, get well, Severin. Don't forget to visit Carbon Con and Cop Lock and check out the podcast these guys have with the Cop Blast and New Hampshire Regional Cop Lock YouTube page, and hit a like and subscribe to all the YouTube channels and the people mentioned, because we do a lot of work and we need more supporters.
Yeah, so once again, this is, you know, we want you to go ahead and check out our show on Monday. It is Cop Blast Podcast. You have myself from Carbon County Cop Block. You've got Scott from Oath Accountability Project. Yep. And you've got Rick Gonzalez, who was on the show earlier. We put a nice little show together.
Allentown Cop Block.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Allentown Cop Block. Sorry about that, Rick. you know what I meant.
And Lehigh Valley.
Yeah, and Lehigh Valley. That's where you got to start.
Yeah, we do a video podcast, and we do all kinds of videos and stuff.
And don't forget.
It's a really fun time.
Yeah, and don't forget JP Freeman on New Hampshire Regional Cop Lock, my mini casts. I do about a 13-minute bit on some of the biggest arguments and sort of some of the big stories that are going on in the area at that time. And
well, guys, it sounds like that's going to be the end of our show. So don't forget to tune in next week at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on LRN Network.